A number of South Texas counties have appeared as poorest by median household income. How can we raise these numbers and help people earn more money?
Okay, well, one more time. A little bit, you're too close to the microphone.
A number of South Texas counties have appeared as poorest by median household income. How can we raise these numbers and help people earn more money?
Okay, well, I've been in a campaign, on the grassroots campaign. I've been down, up and down Santa Maria to Santa Fe, meeting a lot of people and seeing poor communities. I myself at Orange have seen some communities that are very poor and they have dirt floors. Or they have wood right above the dirt. And the rain comes in and it becomes mud in their house. A lot of people have asked me, how can we advance ourselves in becoming better with jobs and stuff? I tell them, well, it starts with you at home. Teach your children that you can do it. You can do something. You can make something of yourself. You can go out there and make a job. And you can raise the money. Nowadays, we have legislation. We have that welfare is the answer for everything. But it's not. What we can do is that we can give less of what we have and come in towards welfare and get a job, earn the money that you can to live a good life. What we have is that we have people that don't, that have gotten used to the fact that welfare is the answer, that's the American dream, but it's not. Going out there, there's always opportunities, there's always jobs out there that we can do. From flipping burgers, something simple, to going out there and being out there and working, cutting yards. There's guys that come to my house and they want to know if I can cut their grass. For $25 for less than 30 minutes, that's pretty good. That's opportunity. And that's something we have here in the United States, and especially here in Texas. We have opportunity. We're a non-union state that anybody can work, and anybody can make more money than they want to. All it is pushing yourself to achieve that. Thank you.
I think that the primary response to how you increase a community's quality of life is through education. And unfortunately in Texas, education has been determined by your geographic birth. Regardless of the fact that you attended public school in Brownsville or San Antonio or Dallas or Plano, the quality of education should be the same. And that's why we go to Austin and fight for opportunities for our public schools in South Texas to have the same quality and access to education. Second is education. We need to be innovative. We can no longer say everybody's going to go on the same path to the same type of secondary education. We need to create job training programs as early as junior high and captivate these young men and women, these young students, and put them towards a field that they're interested in. We have reached out to industry and asked them why they haven't invested in South Texas, and they say sometimes it's hard for us to find the quality of worker that we need to run our factories or to do our manufacturing jobs. We need to bridge that gap, and we do so by partnering with technical colleges, with junior colleges, with universities, and our public school system at an early age so that students can experience technical training and get on a career path. We also have to establish great mentorship programs. Oftentimes, we try to focus on why people fail. We shouldn't do that anymore. We should focus on why those who are born into poor families succeed and make examples of those people and have them come back and tell their stories and inspire our young men and women who grow up in poor families here to say, I can do it too. We need to do more regarding financial literacy. We have kids graduating from high school that are being bombarded with credit card applications and they don't understand how that can get them in trouble. We took that out of our public school system because we're so focused on standardized testing instead of trying to create a holistic approach to education. And finally, there's no substitute for family involvement. And we need to continue to encourage our families to read to their children every night and be involved with their education.
Mr. Oliveira, would you like me to repeat the question?
No, thank you. My distinguished colleague, Representative Lucio, I think, gave a superb answer. And I'll only highlight that with a few points. To break the cycle of poverty, it has always taken a combination of things. It has taken education being the primary component. It has taken a community that cares about its young people. And I think it has taken the business and industry of our area to all be working together hand in hand. Through my terms in the legislature, we have helped coordinate welfare to work programs to try to get people off of welfare and to get them into the workforce. Because I can tell you this, I don't believe a lot of people want to be on welfare. I believe a lot of people would rather have a job and have some pride and some dignity and be able to support their families. I really do believe that. I think what we need to be doing is focusing more, as Representative Brewster said, with the younger children, which we are doing in our public school system. We are going after them hard and heavy and trying to break the dropout rates, which have been excessive and embarrassing to our great state for quite some time. It takes the family. Family has to be role models. Sometimes our families aren't the role models that at least I grew up with, which was a family that worked hard, cared about the community, gave, and did everything they could to help one another. Our society is much more complex, but I think we can break that cycle of poverty, and we have done a pretty good job of it in many areas. We have a lot to do. We have such a growing population with so many young people that a workforce demands, but we have to educate them. That is the great equalizer, education.
Mr. Dominguez, would you like to repeat the question?
That's not necessary. I think Representative Lucio is absolutely correct. Education is a key, but it's not the only key. However, in highlighting a few of the points, currently, 62.3% of the population in this county has a high school diploma or greater. This should be a startling statistic. Statewide, that number is 80%. Only 14.5% have bachelor's degrees or higher over the age of 25. That lets us know that there's an education gap in the valley that doesn't exist in other parts of the state on the average. And yet, about 42 to 44% of the population in Cameron County is under the age of 18. Currently in this county, the per capita poverty rate the median per capita income is $13,500. That's all they make for a whole family. Statewide, it's $24,500, which lets us know something is going on in the rest of the state and we're not getting those benefits here. I think part of that's education. I think we also have a lack of workforce training, and we need to hold folks that we elect accountable for that. Why hasn't there been more dollars coming into Cameron County to train youths to get jobs? Why isn't there more vocational training in our high schools to prepare people who maybe aren't going to go to college, but so they can get a job here, either working in an industry, in a factory, or creating their own jobs? I think whereas we are underserved in our healthcare area, we know that there's a lack of doctors, but not just them. We need nurses, phlebotomists, we need techs. Our high schools can teach these. Institutional programs such as the local colleges can also teach people how to become healthcare technicians. Valley-wide, there's going to be a growing need for in the healthcare field. We need to promote education in these areas to fill those jobs.